So, hi everybody, and today we have a talk by Indro Spinelli, who is a PhD candidate at the Laboratory for Intelligent Signal Processing and Multimedia at Università la Sapienza in Rome. And Indro has a background in computer vision and robotics, and now he's working with Simone Scardapane and Aurelio Uncini. And his research is on trustworthy machine learning for graphs. Let's say more in general graph neural networks, but today he's going to talk about his new work on making graph neural networks more fair with the technique called FairDrop. And so, Indro, you have the floor.
Thanks, Daniele, and thanks for inviting us here. Can you see the slides?
Yes.
Yes, we can. Thank you.
Yes.
Okay, here we are. So I'm going to present you this joint work with Simone Scardapane, Amir Hussein, and Aurelio Uncini. It's entitled Biased Edge Dropout for Enhancing Fairness in Graph Representation Learning. And I think the title explains almost everything. I will briefly introduce you to the concept of fairness, and then we will see its application to graph structured data, and we will end the presentation with our proposed, let's say, solution to this issue. So fairness has been discussed in fields that are very different from computer science and machine learning for a very long time. I was searching for, let's say, a good general definition, and I stumbled I found one that I think is very clear, and it's one of, I think, the one that I like most. And it's the Article 3 of the Italian Constitution from 1948 that states that all citizens have equal social status and are equal before the law, without regard to their sex, race, language, religion, political opinions, and personal or social condition. And it's the duty of the Republic to remove all the economic obstacles to, let's say, achieve this goal. And then goes on and on. And so fairness is a very well-known concept in many different fields, but it came under the spotlight in machine learning in, let's say, just in the recent years, when we started to apply our algorithms to the real world. And mostly fairness is known for some incidents related to bias and to, let's say, the unfair treatment of the minorities. For example, in 2016, some researchers and journalists noticed that the software developed by Amazon used for deciding in which neighborhood they should offer the free same-day delivery was biased against the African-American. In fact, in many cities, if you were white, you were twice as likely to be to live in one of these in this neighborhood. Or another incident, always due to the software, one software of Amazon, is related to the review of the job applicant's resume. And in this case, this software didn't evaluate the resume in a gender-neutral way. In fact, it learned that male candidates were preferable, mostly because it was trained on a 10-year-long period of submitted resume, in which most of them were sent by men. And so, if we want to give a little more clear definition for fairness in the context of decision making, we can define it as the absence of any advantage or discrimination towards an individual or a group based on the traits that we have discussed before. So gender, ethnicity, age, these traits that we consider sensitive. In this scenario, we can think about just one sensitive trait, which is encoded by a single binary attribute, as in this case, which partitions our dataset, in a majority and into a protected minority. Of course, it's quite hard to define fairness, and this broad definition leaves the door open to several different fairness metrics. And we are particularly interested in group-based metrics because we want to measure the gap between the majority and the minority group. And two widespread measures are demographic parity and equalized odds. In the first one, we can consider it satisfied if the likelihood of a positive outcome is the same regardless the value of the sensitive attribute. Equalized odds is a little bit more complicated, and it takes into account also the ground truth of the prediction. And in this case, we want to have equal rates for both true positive and false positive rates. And if you want to dig a little bit deeper into the many metrics that are defined for measuring fairness, you can check this link. And in there, you will also learn that it's not actually possible to satisfy these metrics at the same time. Now, saying that, the bias and the unfairness moves from the data to our models. And this is due to the fact that when we optimize our models, we want to minimize the error rate, which depends strongly on the number of samples. Therefore, if we want to achieve a very high accuracy, what we do is that we prioritize the majority group at the expense of the minority. To counteract this effect and, let's say, slow down the propagation of the bias from the data to the model, we can act at different points of our machine learning pipeline. For example, we can pre-process the data and try to remove the bias from its source, or we can act during the training of our models by including some constraints or adding some terms to the loss function. And finally, once we have a trained model, what we can do is reweight the prediction by setting some threshold such that certain conditions are satisfied on a, let's say, small control set. Now, at the first glance, one can think that by removing explicitly the sensitive information from the dataset, one can solve the problem. But this is not true, because most of the time, this information can leak from other data sources. And in particular, from the combination of other attributes or in the structure of the dataset itself. And this is particularly interesting for graphs. And in fact, the two software of before didn't use explicitly the ethnicity or the gender, but they learned to extract it from other characteristics. For example, they learned to extract the term woman in the resume, like if was present the phrase woman's chess club captain or woman's athlete club. And from these two very dystopic titles of articles, you can see that machine learning's algorithm are very good in extracting this kind of knowledge. Therefore, even if we didn't use it explicitly, may damage our models. Now, talking about graphs, I will just skip all the other fields in which graph neural networks showed, let's say, to have a great success. And I will focus more on social networks and recommender systems, because the datasets are centered around people. And in this case, we have two tasks that are performed frequently and are link prediction and non-representation learning. For the first one, we want to predict whether it's likely that exists a link or a link will be created in the near future between two nodes. In the second one instead, we want to encode the graph structure in a low dimension embedding space. And so with this embedding associated to each node, we can use, let's say, more standard algorithms like logistic regressions, neural networks, random forest, and take into account also the topology of the graph. Of course, once we have learned these node embeddings, we can define several different downstream tasks. And one of them is, of course, the link prediction. Therefore, we can perform link prediction in two ways. The first one is in an end-to-end fashion by using, for example, the latest graph convolutional networks, graph attention networks, and so on. Or we can divide our pipeline into steps. First, we compute the embeddings, and then we predict the links. Now, I said before that the information about the sensitive attribute can be expressed from other data sources. And in this case, for graphs, the tendency of similar nodes to cluster together is a very well-known source of unfairness. And this is known from 2001. And basically, homophily is the principle that nodes with similar characteristics are more likely to be connected. You can think of social networks where people sharing the same ideas or having the same interests are more likely to be friends than the similar ones. Of course, the, let's say, unfair homophily of the sensitive attributes like race, gender, limits the contents accessible by each user and influence their behavior both online and the real world. This because it can polarize all the opinions and of course can create some, let's say, difficulties of talking about from one community to the other. For recommender system instead, Google has a more, let's say, pragmatic approach and put the focus on the fact that if you have, if you're a company that recommends products or want to sell your ads, your advertisement, and you have an incident about fairness, you are very likely to lose customer and you have this, you have no guarantee that you will get it back. And of course, if you receive suggestion of products and these suggestions are based only on some demographic characteristics, you may feel sort of betrayed from these companies. And of course, if you deploy a machine learning model that it's biased and has this bias in its prediction, basically it will make the situation worse and will amplify these biases. In fact, an unfair link prediction has the tendency of increasing the segregation in social networks by promoting links inside the communities defined by the protected attributes. And this creates a bubble, let's say, of ideology and polarize again the opinion of the people. Similarly, a recommender system that learns to associate a certain product to the majority group is subject to a feedback loop where the more the user interacts with this product, the more it will be suggested to the majority and not to, to the minority. Now, what we propose to fight this unfair homophily is a biased edge dropout that we call FairDrop. And we decided it to be easy to integrate into existing solution because it can be applied to a method based on message passing protocols or random walks without the need of any modification. Furthermore, it's also flexible because with just one hyperparameter, we can decide how much the dropout is biased to achieving fairness. And being a sort of just a normal dropout, it doesn't require any crazy computation. We tested FairDrop on the two tasks that we have described before. And for the link prediction, we evaluated the fairness of the predicted link. Instead, for non-representation learning, we evaluated the fairness of the generated node embeddings. And also, we evaluated the accuracy achieved by other classifiers for the downstream task of link prediction. Now, FairDrop, it's based on three step, and we have these small ego networks from the Facebook dataset that will help us to visualize these steps. And in this case, our protected attribute is the gender. So we have a majority gender in red and a minority in blue. And our first step is that we build a mask for the adjacency matrix where we encode just the heterogeneous connections between the sensitive attribute. So this is sort of the inverse of the homophily. Therefore, this mask will have a one only when we connect a male with a female or vice versa. And it will be zero otherwise, of course. Now, since we want to perform a dropout, we need to inject some randomness in this process. And to do so, we will make use of the randomized response, which has the added bonus that allow us to regulate the bias that we impose. And randomized response, it's let's say an ancestor of the inferential privacy, and it was introduced in the late 60s by Warner, and it's used to add a layer of plausible deniability for structured interviews. And basically, with this protection, the respondents are able to answer sensitive questions while maintaining their privacy. So imagine that your municipality, your city, ask all its citizens whether they have stole a car in their life. And of course, you're afraid to answer these questions because if the police discovers that you stole a car, you may get in trouble. But the city who collects the data sees that you can respond this way. First, you throw a coin. If it's tails, then you can answer truthfully. Otherwise, you throw the coin and respond completely at random. Therefore, if the police come to your house because notice that you said that you stole a car during your lifetime, you can always say that you responded in this way because the coin told you to do so. Now, if we express a randomized response with a parameter, in this case delta, we basically will respond truthfully with probability of 0.5 plus delta. And we will flip our answer with probability of 1 half minus delta. And of course, delta lives in the interval between 0 and 0.5. When delta is equal to 0, we basically give a random answer every time. And therefore, the priority protection is maximized, but the data is completely useless. When we set delta equal to 0.5 instead, we will always tell the truth, and we will not have any priority protection. Now, seeing that, we can drop the unfair connection from the original adjacency matrix by performing the Adamard product between our original matrix and the randomized version of the matrix that we have built, that of the mask that we have built before. And in this case, when we set delta equal to 0, we will perform an unbiased edge dropout, because what happens is that we flip every bit of the matrix M at random. Otherwise, if we set delta equal to 0.5, what we do is that we keep all the fair connections, because we just apply the mask that we have built in the first step, and remove all the unfair homophily connections. Of course, we can use any value in between this extreme, and this is the same graph as before, but in this case I've changed the node coloring function to show the ratio between the unfair connection over the total number of edges. And when the node is red, basically it indicates a strong presence of unfair homophily. When it's white, it contains just heterogeneous and thus fair connection. Now, if we apply an unbiased dropout, you can see that even if we have half the number of edges, the colors doesn't change at all. But as soon as we start increasing delta, we promote heterogeneous connection and remove the unfair ones. And the graph starts turning white, up to the point where we set delta equals to 0.5, we keep just the heterogeneous connection. Of course, this is a, let's say it's a dropout. So what we do is that we create different random copies of the original graph and feed them to our learning algorithm and produce fair node embeddings or fair link prediction. Therefore, this can be seen also as a data augmentation pipeline biased through our fairness. Of course, when you modify the graph, you may create a small drop in accuracy, so nothing is for free. Now, measuring fairness, it's on graphs, it's a, let's say, quite hard task. We have to divide the measures for the task we are interested into. And for node representation learning, basically, we consider an algorithm fair if it obfuscates as much as possible the presence of the sensitive attribute from the resulting embeddings. So if we train a classifier to predict the sensitive attribute from this embedding, and it yields the same accuracy of a random classifier, then the embeddings are fair. And therefore, also the downstream task build upon them should too. For link prediction, it's a little bit trickier, because each edge connects two nodes, and thus we have two sensitive attributes in the same prediction. In order to apply the fairness metrics, group fairness metrics used for IID data, we have to take into account this dyadic relation. And what we do is that we build some dyadic groups that maps the sensitive attributes from the space of nodes to the edges. And on these new groups, what we can do is that we can apply the group fairness metrics. Now, our contribution in this case are twofold. We proposed, let's say, an augmentation of the current representation bias used to measure, to track the bias from the embeddings. And what we do is that we concatenate the embedding of two nodes if they share a link in the graphs, and feed them to the algorithm that will output a double prediction, one for each embedding. And the additional knowledge provided as the input of the joint embedding makes the classification task a little bit easier, and thus and it's also more difficult to achieve a good fairness score. For link prediction instead, we have to consider that the way we define the dyadic groups strongly affect what we are going to measure. And two groups are already being discussed in the literature, which are mixed dyadic and subgroup dyadic. We propose a third one, which sits between the two, and aims to create an almost one-to-one mapping from the regional group defined on the nodes and the ones defined on the edges. And this is a visualization. In the upper part, we have how we define this group. So we have a sensitive attribute S associated to the nodes of cardinality 3. And the mixed dyadic group creates two groups, one with the intraconnection and one with the interconnection. And this strongly resembles the way we built our mask, and it's strongly linked to the issue of the filter bubble. Then there is the group dyadic, that is the one that we proposed. And in this case, in order to create an almost one-to-one mapping between the number of groups on the nodes and the number of groups on the edges, we basically count each edge twice, once for the source node and once for the destination node. And this serves to check that no group in particular is responsible for the creation of the links. Then subgroup dyadic instead the groups are created with all the possible combination of sensitive attributes of the nodes. And down here we have the composition of these groups for the CiteSeer dataset, where we used a sensitive attribute the class of the paper. Now, these are two tables taken from the paper. For the node representation learning task, in this case, we have the Facebook dataset, not the small version that you have seen before, but the aggregation of all the ego networks, and it's taken from the Snap repository of Stanford. And for this task, we paired FairDrop with the Node2Vec. And for each batch of random walks, we computed a different random copy of the original input that promotes fairness. And we compared against the bias and fair walk, which are two state-of-the-art methods. And for all the embeddings, we trained three different classifiers, a logistic regression, a neural network, and a random forest, and computed both the classical node representation BS, our proposed link representation BS, and you can see that it has generally higher scores, and the accuracy on the downstream task of link prediction. For the end-to-end link prediction instead, we used a graph convolutional network and a graph attention network, once trained with an unbiased edge dropout and once with a fair drop. In this case, we didn't have any drop in accuracy, but we basically had better score for both demographic parity and equalized odds for almost every dyadic group. Now, to conclude, FairDrop is a method that is very easy to deploy. It's flexible and efficient. Of course, it has some cons. For example, when we have more than one sensitive attribute for a single graph, what we do is basically that we create different unfair homophily masks and alternate them during the training process. And this may be suboptimal. And the other problem is that the concept of homophily, it's a little bit different for bipartite graphs that are spread in the recommender system, and therefore FairDrop cannot be applied as it is. But we are working on them, and if you are interested, feel free to get in touch. And I will end with a general con, which is related to, I think, the whole graph neural network and graph representation learning field, which is the lack of heterogeneous datasets that we can access in an open source fashion. Because, as you've seen before, we use the PubMed dataset together with Core and SetSeer. And sets here, where we set as protected attribute the class associated to the paper. We were fortunate to do this and others before us, because there are no dataset explicitly dedicated to the fairness issue. So I hope that some of them will be released in the near future, because I believe this is a very important topic. So thank you for listening. I will end the final, let's say, acknowledgement to Gannon Kamat and Dilip Rao for sharing their material about differential privacy and fairness open source on the internet. And so thank you.
Thank you so much, Indro. It was a very, very nice presentation. And I think we can open to the people that are listening to the talk, that are present in the room, if they have any questions. Otherwise, I have a few, but I would let other people ask before.
I think that you can go.
Yeah, okay. So I had a question, because when you reported your results about on link prediction, you had actually a slight improvement in performance with respect to, let's say, non-biased edge dropout, right? And this whole methodology anyway got me thinking that what you're essentially doing here is that, like, of course you can interpret this as a fairness from a fairness perspective, but more generally, you're basically trying to prevent what is known as the over-smoothing phenomenon, right? Exactly. Where the majority is basically dictating what the representation of a node will be, depending on the connections. And so I was thinking, I wanted to ask you if you have any comments on that. Like, maybe this idea of moving from homophily to these assortative graphs, or at least trying to promote these assortative connections, is a general way to move forward and improve the representation of GNNs.
Well, there was a very interesting work in, obviously don't remember the name, but it's cited in the paper, in which they basically noticed that these heterogeneous connections for the task of node classification, which is very different from link prediction, actually we're injecting just noise. Mm-hmm. In fact, if you think about node classification, if you have a strong assortativity inside the communities, the task it's easier, because I mean you have the class already, let's say, clustered, so the task is easy. But for the link prediction, it's quite the contrary. Because in this case, you want to promote every type of connection, and you want to limit your prediction to the intranodes. And in this case, when you drop this unfair homophily connections, basically you are trying to make every node embedding a little bit different from the other. And in this case, maybe what you do is that it's easier to predict link for each single node instead of flattening the representation for the nodes in the same community.
Yeah.
So I think this is the effect. And I think that also in, which is basically the inverse of what the authors of this paper found for the node classification task. So to me, it seems quite reasonable way of thinking about it.
Yes, and also like there are papers recently that study the effect of over smoothing, especially when you're looking at coarsening, and they found out that if you have too much of this kind of phenomenon, then the coarsening itself is sometimes useless. So thank you for your answer. And if nobody else wants to go, I still have another question, but otherwise we can maybe somebody came up with something.
Oops.
Okay, I see Simone.
Yes,
Simone has a question.
No, I wanted to thank Daniele for the moderation because you're born to be a conference organizer.
Yeah.
May I ask a question?
Yes, of course.
So, do you have any experience of having multiple biases in your data that you want to remove as much as possible, but attempting to remove one actually works and the opposite to the other, so that you either have to remove one or the other, but not both?
No, actually, I do not have experience, because we didn't have dataset of that type. And there was one, which is movie lens, I think, but that the graph is bipartite, it's bipartite, and therefore applying FairDrop as it is wasn't very successful, so I didn't dig deeper in that direction, but it's something, of course, that we want to, give a better look. And if you have any data set that you can share with us, maybe we can come up with something, but otherwise I have no experience with this type of data sets.
No, not really, honestly. I was just wondering, as a first question, coming to the second one, if there is the possibility that attempting, let's say that you have in mind only one bias and you try to cope with that, if there is the possibility that coping with that you know it is in there, can cause as a side effect the appearance of other biases that you may not know in advance, or maybe not observe.
Yeah, in fact, when I tried working on movie lens, I basically alternated at every epoch the mask over which we computed the unfair homophily. So once for one an attribute, once for the other, such that the final process maybe worked for every attribute, but as I said, this may be very suboptimal, and maybe you mask him up in a way of combining this sensitive attribute before computing the mask and before applying the dropout, such that you apply once and for all the sensitive attributes that you have.
Thanks.
You're welcome.
So since you mentioned the movie lens dataset twice already, I actually had a question about this bipartite idea, and more generally, like not only bipartite graphs, but heterogeneous graphs as well. Like, so when edges are inherently defined between things that may not even share the same domain. Mm-hmm. So what are your ideas about that? Like, what are you working on, if you can share it, of course, or at least if you can give us some pointers on how to deal in that case with defining, like, how do you even define unfairness in that case where you need to consider at least second order relations, right?
Yeah, actually, it's a completely different case, because FairDrop is based on the assertivity of the graphs and the fact that social networks and recommender systems share these characteristics. And I don't know if it makes sense in the sense, for example, on what graph you are working on that have this assertive nature. I mean, if it's dataset where the data is built and it's centered around people, then It's of course worth investigating, but you, in that case, you have to change completely the paradigm. And otherwise, if I don't know if it makes sense using fairness for, I don't know, molecular design. Maybe you can help with over-smoothing, but that's a completely different problem.
Yes, I agree. I agree. It kind of makes sense only if you're working with people. So yeah.
Yeah, if you can make some example of these assorted graphs and the ones you are working on.
No, I'm not working on anything. Like I know that technological networks tend to be this assortative, like many small websites connect to a big website, and then that maybe is like a kind of a hidden variable that still has people behind. Yeah. And I know that like some biological networks tend to be this assortative, but I'm not working on anything specifically here. Mm-hmm. So no, it was just a curiosity.
Mm-hmm. I think that requires a complete change of on how we set the problem and how we compute. Computing a mask in that case will be useful.
Yeah. Thank you.
Welcome. Okay.
Yeah. So I think we can wrap up. So thank you very much, Indro, for being with us today, for giving this nice talk. I guess if anybody is interested in reading more about the paper, they can find it on archive. We'll put the link on our website so people can find it. So thank you very much for being with us.
Thank you.
Absolutely, Indro. Thank you so much. And bye. Bye.